The irresponsible conundrum of gender-based priority politics is only used as a deterrent and not as a tangible result for liberation by using the American political structure. It is a placebo and not medicine for the healing. It is a weaponized effort to strike animosity and competition between blacks who descended from American slaves, both men and women. As I sit here as a presidential candidate, I'm forced to hear sound bites from the Democratic Party issuing out fake allegiance towards black women. And in this effort of fake allegiance, they expose their true colors, and it is the color of white supremacy. Their tactics of divisive discourse runs parallel with their tactics of brutal force, stretching all the way back from the cotton fields of antebellum slavery. White supremacy had to create divide in the black family unit. And one tactic was to emasculate the alpha male of the household. By emasculating the person who is supposed to represent protection and provision, interfered with the hierarchy of the black family unit, forcing the black woman to stop considering him as head of household. This was a sinister and diabolical tactic, because women naturally look up to men for leadership, provision, and protection. And it is something that nature instills in humans. And eviscerating this biological structure leaves the people in that society more vulnerable, because by castrating the men, castrates natural strength, provision, and protection. The white overseer had to strip the black man completely down in front of his woman, leaving her with a sense of vulnerability that a woman should never feel. A black woman's femininity deserves protection and provision, but that was taken away from her. And some were even convinced to trade in that protection and provision from black men for the protection and provision of white men. And the protection of white men would never be fully enforced, because a white woman will always have priority under the umbrellas of security elevated by white men. The white woman's femininity will always be valued higher. And with the castration of strong black men solidifies a secondary, third, fourth, and last place back burner position, stripping the black woman from her right to be a man's queen to only being his concubine. What's even worse, many of these women have been convinced to breed offspring with this white man, extracting away the birthright of lineage. She was convinced to breed away her birthright of building the wealthiest nation in the entire world that will eventually force correct compensation for her heirs. This task of demanding and forcing compensation is a difficult task enough for blacks who descended from American slaves, but will serve as an even harder task for people born who understand that they are black, but whose DNA has been intermingled so much that their racial classification is unclear and hard to determine. Many of those people would not be able to be accepted as white, but will also not be classified as black, due to political propaganda to create a separate mulatto class in America. Their inheritance has been bred away, and their birthright has been sold away, because their mothers wanted more white acceptance. The Democratic Party sells black women a false narrative of white male patriarchy in relation to black men, as if black men benefit from patriarchy. Black men do not reap the benefits of patriarchy, and it is only reserved for white men. And benefiting from patriarchy would serve as a blessing for black women if we only had it, because that would equate to evidence that our power as men was not stripped away from us. Black men who descended from American slaves are at the bottom of the totem pole, and we share this bottom position with black women. It is a position that both black men and black women wallow in, scrapping in the mud for the scraps that mass have thrown to us, and fighting each other instead of working together only exposes both of our weaknesses. By working together, we set codes of ethics, gender roles that God and Mother Nature designed. There was never a successful civilization built by women, and there was never a population of humans born by men. We will demand that black men take charge by providing and protecting our women from the strongholds of white supremacy. But our women must allow the men to lead without gripe. We would set an example for our sons and grandsons so that we can take back our rightful claim. And the Democratic Party fear this in all efforts by using antebellum slave tactics, trying to convince black women that their vote counts and not ours, trying to convince them that they should beckon for political leadership over us, creating a very unnatural picture of black women in masculinity and black men in femininity. If black women cannot depend on their own men for leadership, protection, and provision, then which man will step up? The white man, the Asian man, the Hispanic man? It is an element of delusion. Sure, these men would love to have rather sidekick, a side chick, a piece of concubine dimwit without a black man in sight with a pistol to run upside his head to check in with. Sure, that'd be their desire. While white women, Asian women, Hispanic women, and everybody else sit in the Queen's chair. This is presidential candidate Deion D. Jenkins, the only legitimate reparations presidential candidate, the only black agenda priority presidential candidate. And I approve this message. Thanks for listening.